order the unruly wills and affections of sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed where true joys are to be found. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Our first reading this morning comes from the book of Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. A covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm this morning is Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness.
In your great compassion, blot out my offenses.
Wash me through and through from my wickedness.
And cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions.
And my sin is ever before me.
Only against you have I sinned.
And done what is evil in your sight.
And so you are justified when you speak,
and upright in your judgment.
Indeed, I have been wicked from my birth,
a sinner from my mother's womb.
For behold, you look for truth deep within me,
and will make me understand wisdom secretly.
Purge me from my sin, and I shall be pure.
Wash me, and I shall be clean indeed.
Make me hear of joy and gladness,
that the body you have broken may rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins,
and blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a clean heart, O God,
and renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence,
and take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Give me the joy of your saving help again,
and sustain me with your bountiful spirit.
Our second lesson is a reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, You are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been destined by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Festival were some Greeks, and they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." And Philip went, and he told Andrew, and then Andrew and Philip went, and they told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it. And those who hate their life in this world will keep it for an eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me. And where I am, there will be my servant also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." And then a voice came from heaven. "I have and I will glorify it again. And the crowd standing there heard it and said, it was thunder. And others said, an angel has spoken to him. And Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of the world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Come, Holy Spirit, giver of life, inspire our hearts and minds with your truth and the truth of Jesus, that we might follow and worship. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. Let's talk today about the word conversion. The dictionary says a conversion is the process of changing or causing something to change from one form to another. And this word is used in many ways and in many contexts. In the building construction trades, you convert a house into apartments or something like that. In law and legal forms, you change real property and convert it into personal property. In the money realm, when Susan and I were in Israel, we converted US dollars into Israeli shekels. In the marketing realm, when you view something online and then go ahead and buy it, they call that a conversion. So interesting word, comes up in psychiatry, in physics, and even in football. You can get a 1-point or a 2-point conversion. It also comes up in religion. It can mean changing one's religion. A Christian converts to Islam or Buddhism or vice versa. In evangelicalism, the emphasis is on becoming a Christian. At one point you are not a Christian, and then you convert and become a Christian. The focus here is usually on a point in time where one makes a decision for Christ. Some of you maybe can point to such an event in your life, at a church service, or in a revival meeting, maybe long ago in a Billy Graham crusade, or just in a conversation with a friend. When I was in seminary in Pasadena, there was a Syrian named Mustafa. He had been a Syrian army officer, and somehow or other he came in contact with the New Testament. And on his own, he began to read it. And he was converted and became a follower of Jesus just from reading the New Testament. His family tried to kill him because he had converted. Conversion can be dangerous. Others find it harder to pin down a point in their lives. Conversion is more like a long, slow process. Fundamentalist revivalism in camp meetings, that's where I grew up. You heard hellfire and damnation preaching, and the invitation was to go to the altar. If I had a dollar for every time I went to an altar as a boy, I might be fairly wealthy. Every time you heard those sermons and heard those songs, for years, every time I heard "I am persuaded," I felt like I needed to get up and go to the altar for everything. I mean, I could have just been on the Holy Mount talking with Jesus and Moses and Elijah, and if "I am persuaded" had started, I would have said, "Let's kneel down and pray." Conversion is also used in Benedictine spirituality, which has had a big impact upon our prayer book. The Latin phrase is conversatio morum, translated conversion of life or conversion of manners. It's the whole process of changing a sinner into a saint. However it is used in Christianity, conversion means change, whether at a point in time or a process, but something is being changed. And I bring this up and focus on this word because Lent is all about conversion. We are meant to be changed by observing Lent and its practices. Those practices, giving alms, fasting, prayer, scripture reading, self-examination, all of these practices in our lives, whether as individuals or corporately as a church, will change us over time as we grow closer to Christ and are conformed and converted into His image. We will either do these practices and grow, be transformed as Christians, or we will do them and stagnate. In the Christian life, you see there, you are either moving forward or you are sliding backwards. There's no place just to stay the same. All four of the scripture lessons today, we hear about conversion in different ways. In the Old Testament reading, the prophet Jeremiah conveys the words of God to the people. Jeremiah was a prophet right before and during the exile. Babylon had destroyed Jerusalem, carried off many captives. This was God's judgment on a rebellious nation. So God institutes a change, a conversion, a new form of covenant. The law of God, which formerly had been external, summarized in the Torah, the books of Moses, which Israel couldn't and wouldn't obey, will now be written on the hearts of God's people. Notice, it is God who causes this conversion. The people will be changed, but only due to God's action. An old covenant converted to a new covenant. In the epistle, in the letter to the Hebrews, a different kind of conversion is in focus. Jesus, the incarnate Son of God, who will later be called the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Get that? Pioneer and the starter? The one who perfects it on the way? Jesus is converted. Think about that. Beware, because of his exaltation to the right hand of the Father at his ascension, we tend to forget and sometimes even downplay his humanness. The text says he learned obedience through what he suffered. His humanness, in every way like us, was converted, changed into perfection. So all conversion is not from bad to good. Sometimes it's from better to perfect. Meditate on that sometimes. What it must have meant for Jesus, living in the same fallen world that we live in. How he grew into the knowledge of his relationship with his Father. Maybe some of our conversion will also be from what is okay to something that is better, to what God created us to be. In the Gospel from John, we have another idea of conversion. Jesus uses the metaphor of a grain of wheat buried in the earth, being converted and changed into a plant bearing much fruit. Jesus is obviously talking about his own journey. He is the grain of wheat. Crucified and buried, he is raised to be the first fruits of God's kingdom. By conversion, Jesus brings to pass what Jeremiah prophesied. He invites us into the same reality, death to our old life, raised to new life, converted into one that bears fruit for God's kingdom. Once again, that is what Lent is all about. In fact, that's what the whole Christian life is all about. A continuous process of conversion from an old self to the new self that God has created. If someone asks you, were you converted? It's right to say yes. And to still say, I am still being converted. Praise God. Once and again, notice, it is God who does the converting. We experience the result in our lives. This Christian life is not a long, arduous struggle to make ourselves better. You try that and you will come to failure. We can't do it. Like our pioneer Jesus, we submit all of ourselves to him. And from the inside, he changes our hearts. Once again, his concern is to get heaven into us. And when that happens, we begin to act like he did. But there's one other practice which is involved in Lent. And in the whole Christian life, really, self-denial. For as much as we have already been changed, have already been converted, we still have a ways to go. At least I do. There is still much within me that needs to be changed. Which brings us to the psalm for today. The Psalms are always a response in our liturgy to the Old Testament reading. In Jeremiah, God is addressing the people who were rebellious. Psalm 51 is one of the great Psalms. If you haven't used this Psalm, haven't slowly meditated on it sometime, haven't prayed it as your own heart cry, then you have been missing out. In this psalm, we come before God, aware of our sin, aware of our brokenness. We come before God, aware that of ourselves, in our own power, we are helpless. It's a great psalm. I could easily extend this sermon for another hour or two, talking about all the treasures in this psalm. I'm going to focus quickly on two verses. In verse 5, it says, and so you, God, are justified when you speak and upright in your judgment. Now, we have a tendency to not like the word judgment and the idea of God judging us. We fear God's disapproval of his chastisement of punishment. As if God is out to get us. But that is a very wrong way of thinking about God's judgment. When God judges, God is sorting things out. He's like a doctor, a physician, coming to a diagnosis of what's wrong. Only with the truth of our condition can there be healing. If you have cancer, you don't want some doctor saying you have a mild flu. You want a true judgment, a diagnosis. God examines us and judges us in order to bring us to health and wholeness. Always, God seeks our best. Verse 7, "For behold, you look for truth deep within me, and will make me understand wisdom secretly." Have you ever done something, acted in some way, and later wondered, why did I do that? Okay, Jeff, you can leave. Or maybe had a Freudian slip where you blurt out something that you later regret. Or had an intense anger reaction all out of proportion to some little mild event. These are all indications of the depth of human personality. Half the time, we don't really know why we do things or react in such ways. But God knows. He knows the depths of us. God knows at a deeper level than we understand. God can sort us out. You remember the seven deadly sins? Pride, greed, wrath, envy, lust, gluttony, sloth. God knows that these are cancers that if left within us will kill us. We will be spiritually dead. They afflict us. They compromise our lives and our relationship. And God wants to heal us. He wants to convert us. When we come to God in the spirit of Psalm 51, we open ourselves to God's healing work deep within us, conforming us to His Son, our Lord Christ. In the collect of the day, there's this wonderful phrase, "Almighty God, you alone can bring into order the unruly wills and affections of sinners." Do you identify with that? Unruly will. We come to God, we say, "Here we are, Lord. Grant us the grace of conversion, that we may be changed into the likeness of Jesus. To the glory of your name.
Let us together affirm our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
My brothers and sisters in the Lord, let us join together our hearts and minds and pray to our Lord. The hour has come. Now is the time to glorify God's name. Let us intercede for the church and for all God's creation, turning to God and saying, Lord, your kingdom come. You are our God. May those who are poor and those who are rich, those who are near and those far, welcome your covenant of peace, we pray.
Lord, your kingdom come.
We are your people. Be with our presiding bishop, Michael, our bishop, Megan, for those who minister in this congregation, and for all your holy church, we pray.
Lord, your kingdom come.
You honor those who choose to serve. Help us to be true followers of your servant's son, we pray.
Lord, your kingdom come.
We know that we must die, so that we may truly live. Strengthen all who suffer in mind or body, especially.
John, Valerie, Marjorie, Bob, Emilia, Helena, Don, Marcia, Chris, Kaylin, Patsy, Pat G, John, Frank, Alyssa, Pat M, Megan, Danielle, Curtis, Carter T, Mary Ann, Barbara, Mark C, David, Todd, Deborah, Aaron, Charlene, Patrick, Mary, Dick T, Audrey, Joshua, DJ, Timothy and Marie, Rodney and Rudy,
and others for whom we offer our prayers. Let's lift them up, silently or aloud. We pray for Ronnie. We pray,
Lord, your kingdom come.
You draw all people to yourself. Bring us out of our slavery to possessions, and away from the desire for wealth, we pray.
Lord, your kingdom come.
Lord God, show us the way of obedience through patient endurance, and the way of glory through the law written in our hearts. Hear our prayers and come to our aid. We pray through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name.
Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Amen.
Please rise. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
You may be seated. Wonderful to see all of you again today. Wonderful to have Donna back with us this morning. Wonderful to have my daughter Amber with us today. Some of our members are traveling and around and all. We are here and God is good to us. This is not true. Are there any birthdays today that we are celebrating?
Oh, you're one right
there. We have a brand new birthday.
That's right. And his name?
Sebastian.
Okay. Any others? Okay, bring up the birthday prayer then, and let us pray together for Sebastian. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servant Sebastian as he begins a new year. Grant that he may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen his trust in your goodness all the days of his life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Are there any anniversaries we're celebrating? Okay, Ronnie had this
knee operation
and
very painful.
Are you sure that he is home now or?
I'm not.
Okay.
He said he was going to be home maybe the same day unless something came up.
So I haven't been able to get in contact with him, but when you visited him, he was in a lot of pain and all of that. So we're going to pray the beginning of recovery for Ronnie.
Oops.
That's not the one.
No. I did, sir.
There we go. Let us pray. O Lord, your compassions never fail, and your mercies are new every morning. We give you thanks for giving our brother Ronnie both relief from pain and hope of health renewed. Continue in him, we pray, the good work that you have begun, that he may daily increasing in bodily strength and rejoicing in your goodness, may so order his life and conduct, that he may always think and do those things that please you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Are there any other prayers that you would bring before us? I have been charged by the bishop of our diocese to read a letter to you. So I will read this and then I will post it back on the bulletin board later if you want to go over it again. Dear brothers and sisters in the Diocese of Northern California, greetings on this fifth Sunday of Lent. We are 1 week away from Palm Sunday and then on to Holy Week and Easter Sunday. Looking ahead to the season of Eastertide, I invite you to join in our upcoming Fearless Faith Revival. On Saturday, April 27th, we will gather at the beautiful campus of St. John's Church in Roseville for an afternoon and evening of learning, sharing, fellowship, and worship. My friends, as a people of faith, we are in need of revival. In a time of wars, political tensions, economic struggles, and destructive weather, we have been tested and tried. Jesus himself took time from the demands of his ministry to connect with his Father and recharge his spirit. This is our time to gather together, to worship, break bread, to pray, and to strengthen the bonds which make us a people of God. The highlight of our revival will be the worship service, featuring music, prayers, and preaching by our special guest, Bishop Daniel Gutierrez of the Diocese of Pennsylvania. This energetic, spirit-filled event will end with a call to prayer and service. You will not want to miss this. The Fearless Faith Revival will bring friends and colleagues from around the diocese to hear from beloved speakers working in the Episcopal Church and to recharge our batteries. It will bring us closer to what God calls us to do in the church. We will be planting love, harvesting hope, and a walking away with a fearless faith, ready to share the love and passion for our Lord Jesus Christ with our communities. In addition, we are hosting workshops taught by leaders from around the country on creation care, evangelism, racial reconciliation, community involvement, and meeting the needs of different generations of faith seekers. The Revival Festival will feature ministry partners, exhibitors, vendors, and popular local food trucks. We will have prayer stations, contemplative spaces, and an outdoor labyrinth where you can walk prayerfully. And there will be a special area for kid-friendly activities. All activities at the revival will be free. As you know, our diocese gathers in person each fall for our annual convention. An important part of convention is the opportunity to join in lunch or occasionally a special dinner for delegates and clergy. This year, however, our convention will be held entirely online. As a result, the Fearless Faith Revival will be the only day we will gather in person as a diocese. My friends, hosting this revival is a huge undertaking of dedicated staff and volunteers from the entire diocese. It requires a significant investment of time and money. While much of the funds have been allocated by the Board of Trustees, there is still a need to defray the cost. One way that we hope to defray these expenses is a special dinner on the eve of the revival. On Friday, April 26, we will host a Fearless Feast fundraising dinner at Trinity Cathedral, featuring locally sourced foods and beverages. This event will provide a unique opportunity to meet and mingle with leaders from across the country. I realize the cost to attend may be a burden for many, but all may gather to eat together at the Revival Festival the next day. If you cannot join us for the Fearless Feast, please consider making a gift to help underwrite this milestone. I believe that God has brought us as a diocese to this moment, and that God is now calling us to experience of his renewal as a community. I urge you to send as many congregants as you can to join with me in responding to God's action among us. We will find our thinking deepened in the workshops, our fellowship revived, and spirits warmed and encouraged. I am convinced that it is only from that place of praise and presence that we can begin to move outward to the whole community engagement to spread the good news. In joyous anticipation, Bishop Megan. Kind of a long letter with a lot in it. I will post it back there. But just in shorthand, April 27th, it's a Saturday. It's in Roseville, not too far away. I hope that a bunch of us can go, we can carpool together, and all there's going to be workshops I'm particularly interested. There's a workshop by a specialist in Latino ministries, and there's a workshop in evangelism. We're, a lot of good things going on there that we can be a part of. A lot of times for fellowship, for prayer, and then a great revival service that evening. So I encourage you to think about it, and let's plan together how we might go together as a church. Let us pray. Gracious God, you know our hearts for all our neighbors. Help us and guide our path as we seek to live lives of fearless faith, loving service, and confident hope. We give you thanks and praise for all the ways you are present and moving in our community. May this time of revival bring both spirit-filled personal renewal and social transformation marked by justice and healing. For these and all your blessings, we give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Walk in love as Christ loved us, gave himself an offering and sacrifice unto God. Throughout the season of Lent, we've been hearing songs about journeying and travel, because we are on a Lenten journey. And so today, we're going to sing another journeying song that focuses not on so much where we're coming from, but where we're going to. And this is a call and response song, so I'm going to sing a line and you have to sing it back to me. It's one of those kinds of songs. And I'll start off just slow to get us started.
I'm on my way
to Canaan.
Creatures, hear me.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way, as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over every evil, and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament to serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ had taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood from your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord.
To him, to you, and to
the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Look with compassion, O Lord, upon this your people, that rightly observing this holy season, they may learn to know you more fully and to serve you with a more perfect will. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Amen.
Glory.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.